Hello everyone, I am in my office slash study being attacked by this plant. In late March, when we first went into lockdown, I recorded a video that I never uploaded about pandemic books that I was reading and why I like to read things about the pandemic while we are having a pandemic and going through it. And in general, why I like to read things about that mirrors, I guess, that are kind of political affairs and current affairs and the difference between escapism and reading things that are that very much parallel our experiences. But yeah, I never uploaded it. I didn't know why. I think I was just never happy with it. So I was thinking about the video I should make for Vlogmas, and I know I should make a Christmas gift guide for books, but what I want to make is this pandemic video, so that's what I'm going to do today. I do have some ginger cordial, thank you for noticing. This is a mix of books I have read and books I haven't read, fiction, non-fiction, essays, whatever. The first one I'm going to start with is Severance by Ling Ma, which I read back in spring and absolutely loved. It's very satirical, it's very dark, and there are so many parallels to at least like the spread of the pandemic as in our experience, that it's like it's weird. And yeah, remember that I was reading this in March. I think it's called like the Shenzhen flu, I can't remember it. Our protagonist, Candace, is very much like focused in her own world and her own routines and her own patterns, and she's not super plugged in with everything else that's going on. So in a way, the situation kind of takes her by surprise. It kind of creeps up on her a little bit, and then she finds herself in a situation where she's in a group of survivors. What I like about this, as with so much sci-fi, is that it creates a situation in which you can ask those big philosophical questions, that you can ask what we'd do and how we'd behave in those situations where you are one of a handful of people with a certain amount of power and a certain amount of decision making, and having to choose to sort of step into that power and where you'll guide it. And how does sickness or infection affect how we construct a human? Because the illness in this essentially kind of turns people into zombies, or some version of zombies, or some ghost of themselves. They're just like not present. So how does that affect how you treat them and how you organize your life around them and so on? So there were just like so many different questions to pick out, and as I'm even talking about it, I'm ready to reread it. But I loved it, and it was really fascinating to read it at the time that I did, when things were just unfolding and information was quite bitty, but we were full on lockdown here, and like you couldn't go outside for more than an hour a day to exercise. The book in general made me think a lot about our ambitions and aspirations in our life, what we think is important for our life, like the measures of success we have for ourselves. And I think that something that like the reassessment of it has happened for so many different people during this pandemic, myself included. And the biggest one for me has been like not traveling as much, and just sort of being in one place and the certain kinds of stability that that has afforded me. As I say now, I just want to reread it. But if you have read it, I would love to hear maybe more like coherent pictures for this book. In general, whenever I make book reviews, I'm like, I don't really talk about the plot. I just talk about the questions it made me think of. And I like that, because I like that's how I read. But I also know that that's maybe not what you're looking for with book reviews. Anyway, that's what we've got. That's what I've got to offer. This book, I Who Have Never Known Men, is what I would call like a lockdown novel. It was written in French originally and published in 1995, and then was translated into English in 98, I believe. But we encounter our protagonist, a young woman in a bunker. And she's in the bunker with, I think, 39 other women. And they live their whole lives inside the cell, and there are guards, and there is sort of a culture of not trying to orchestrate an escape for whatever reason, because they're not treated very well. In a lot of ways, it has a lot of parallels to like the tone of Handmaid's Tale. I don't want to say too much more about the plot itself, but I just loved the internal voice of this, and I loved what it chose to reveal about what happened to the world. Because you don't even know if they're on Earth. Like, you don't know if they're on Earth or some other planet, because you know exactly as much as the protagonist does about just like being in the dark And in so many ways, that's like, that mirrors our experience of like life in the universe and having to live with the amount of knowledge that we have at the given time that we're alive. But it also is very much like itself a metaphor for storytelling and how slowly little bits of the story are revealed to you, but never like the entire world, like never absolutely every detail you want. But there is a level of like illuminating the path and the next step. The next book I want to recommend is A Children's Bible by Lydia Millet, which has the most amazing cover. I absolutely love it. This came out during the pandemic. This came out, I think, in May or June this year. I ordered it through Daunt Books and they posted it to me, and I felt very special. It felt like getting a little present. They wrapped it all up really nicely. In this story, there are 12 kids and their parents basically make them go on this holiday to this like massive mansion, like this huge, huge house, and then completely ignore them the whole time and just get really drunk and like have a like non-stop party. And there's something else going on outside, like there's something on in the background, and the kids are like quite aware of it. They're very aware of like something being up, but they also have all these different games that they play. Like no one really knows who's parents and who's kids, so they try and like not have that be discovered. There's like a bit of a, like a summer camp feel about it. The kids essentially like make their own world. I feel like if you liked books like We Were Liars, then this is one that you'll really like. It had like, there were lots of different things that made me think of it. Made me think of Never Let Me Go, especially like the younger portions of it. And it also made me think of, oddly, a lot of the books that I read when I was really young, like Famous Five and that sort of thing, of like just of that feeling of like kids banding together. But it's brilliantly written, so, so beautifully done. Has a bit of the like, not quite Lord of the Flies element, but like something of that, like that question of what kind of society would kids make? The sense of parents, and obviously like they're really representing like an older generation having stopped paying attention to what's going on, and something really catastrophic happening, and them kind of like excusing themselves from the problem and choosing instead this like very debaucherous entertainment, while the kids have to sort of figure it all out. But yeah, I really loved A Children's Bible, and it, oh gosh, every time I see this cover, I just think it's like one of the most perfect. And it's not one I've heard loads of people talking about who I do know like to read these kinds of things. So yes, if you have not read that, read it. It is available for you. I made a video with Sana on Sana's channel about the books we got out of the library once we knew that this was going to hit. And I really like got in there requesting all of my, all the things I wanted to read or had already read about dystopias, pandemics, and so on. And one of the ones I requested was World War Z, which I'd never read before. And it took me, because my focus completely went during the first lockdown. I found it so hard to read. My brain just couldn't click on there. I watched loads of films and I loved doing that, but I just couldn't focus on books for some reason. So I think it took me 3 or 4 months to read World War Z, which is told in an oral history form. I really liked the idea of it. Sometimes I struggled with a bit of the execution, like I felt like I had to work really hard with it. But I think that like the idea of telling a story through oral history and finding a way to do that is really interesting to me. Like I love the way Daisy Jones and the Six does that, for instance. And I think so much of what I was looking for in these books, and very much with the next one that I'm going to talk about, is a sense of what happens afterwards. Because when you're in the middle of something, you're like, sorry, when's this gonna end? What's gonna happen? And something that keeps coming up lately, especially because we are now in December, is that so many of my friends have been like, you said from the start that like this was not gonna be over by the end of the year. Like how, and Sana even said like, it was helpful that you said that because it helped me put things in context. I think for me, like having that expectation really helped, but also I needed some sense of like, even in the worst case scenario, when people become zombies, what happens next? How do we get out of this? What's the like heroic story for this? And it probably explains why I've watched Contagion several times during this as well. So this one is one that I feel like all of book YouTube knows. It's Station 11 by Emily St. John Mandel. I love this book. First time I read it, I didn't like it. Don't know why. There might even be a video up on here somewhere about me after I first read it. But I had such a strong like no reaction to it. I wonder if it was just because it was getting popular, but it's now one of my favourite books and I've read it 4, 5, 6 times. I've read it 3 times this pandemic, and yes, because my library hasn't reopened yet, I've been able to keep it this entire time, which is obviously, like, I feel quite bad actually for the people who are requesting it, but quite happy for myself to have it. This is a story told in sort of 2 different timelines. The timeline of when the pandemic hits and the slowly, well, not that slowly, the escalating sense of it and how it spreads around the world, and the sort of like lag between the news and actually the speed of the pandemic, which I think really mirrors our experience, at least here in the UK, of like, oh, we're hearing about news over there, and then actually it's already, people are already infected and so on. I think it's 20 years later of the world after, you know, what happens after the end of the world, as Patrick Ness always puts it. It's just so carefully told. There are so many different narrators. It's really beautiful. Like, there are scenes that I just remember. I feel like I've seen them because it's so well described. Picturing snow in particular, and so much of it is told through memory that it feels like they're your memories, but they're not. They're the memories of all these different characters. So you feel like you're looking through the memories of other people. And even that feeling is sort of laid out quite literally in what one of the characters chooses to do. You have this sense of fragments from this old world coming through into this new world that's been created. And this hard line of this thing that happened that was absolutely terrible and completely devastating. And yet something that managed to filter through those cracks, you know. When I'm describing it now, I'm thinking of when, I can't remember what it's called, oh my gosh, this is going to escape me. When you look at the cross section of rock, the meteor hit, and there's that big line of black, things still continue. Like, that's what I'm thinking about. And so much of what I did during lockdown was the first lockdown, once I had my bike, I would go into central London and cycle around, and it would just be really helpful for me that even though it was silent and eerie and most closely reminded me of what London was like right after the 2005 terrorist attacks, that was a very unsettling feeling. Being able to go into London and cycle into central London and cycle all around reminded me that, like, it's all still there. Like, even though we were all in lockdown, or in kind of very slightly eased lockdown at that point, it was all still there. And like, I could go to Hampstead Heath and be like, the trees are still here and they've made it through something longer than this. Like, there are trees on that heath that have made it through pandemics before, for sure. And so I think there is that sense of just like, life finds a way, people go on, life continues, that I was looking for very much, and that Station 11 really delivers, while also adding these levels of like drama and rising narrative in a really effective way, in a way that I really admire. So those are the fiction books that are most closely related to our current situation. I also wanted to mention a few that are like slightly more tangentially related, that I had been reading or had recently read, or I just kept thinking about. Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents by Octavia Butler, I thought a lot about, especially in terms of kind of how society decides who's important and how power has such a big impact on that, but also the sense of like quiet resistance to that, and even sometimes accidental resistance by like choosing something different. You can build up this family or build up this different group of people around you who share your values and share your beliefs. It was mostly like that sense of power, of hierarchy, of what happens when people are put in a point of desperation and then other people manipulate that, especially in Parable of the Talents. We read Parable of the Sower in Life's Library, and then Parable of the Talents is the one that's set a little bit further on in the narrative. And there was supposed to be a third one, but Octavia Butler died before she was able to write it. And then the other pair of fiction books I was thinking a lot about are Hank's books, An Absolutely Remarkable Thing and A Beautifully Foolish Endeavour, which I think a lot of people have said this, especially on, you know, the TikTok, are just eerily prescient in a lot of ways, but it's because Hank really understands how the internet appeals to certain elements of our lust for power, I say, and also how communities respond to global events and the good of it and the bad of it. So all the good community-centered peace and love style 70s stuff really comes through in some ways, but then also how that can turn and the people who sort of take advantage of that too. And also just like the fraying of that over time, especially as this pandemic has gone on. There's kind of like a turning inwardness, at least I sort of feel that now, where before it was very much about thinking about the most vulnerable and doing what we can to protect the most vulnerable. There's a certain turn towards individualism that I think is born of fear and is something that we have seen over the last few years, certainly here in the UK, but that is a switch I can definitely see, and I think that Hank explores that really well. I also, whenever I read, I reread An Absolutely Remarkable Thing a lot, and whenever I read it, like, I read it in one day because I can't put it down. It is literally unputdownable. And speaking of current events, if you know about the monolith, then you will enjoy this. Oh, I also wanted to say that I read Pale Horse, Pale Rider, which is a short story by Katherine Ann Porter about the 1918 flu pandemic, and I loved it. I thought it was really beautifully done. It had this feeling of almost being ahead of it again, that lag of like not quite realizing what was happening, and then that delayed realization of the events of it. And one of the things I really love about short stories is that they're short enough that you can go back and then read them again. But yes, I thought that was fantastic. I had that from the library again, but I actually just lent it to Sana, and that was one that I really relished. There are lots of other stories in that collection that I liked a lot too, because a lot of them involved Mexico. On my fiction TBR, speaking of Sana, Day of the Triffids, I read when I was really young. I think my dad had it or something. He definitely mentioned it a lot, but I feel like he had it, but I don't really remember it very well, so I went to reread that. And then Camus, The Plague, feels like one that everyone was reading earlier this year, and I actually didn't get around to reading it, but that was one of the ones that I ordered during the summer, I'm just excited to read it. If you've watched this channel a long time, you might remember a video I made oh so many years ago in which I quoted Camus, and then I will never forget, say, Albert Camus once wrote. Who's Albert Camus? Oh, bless my younger self. I'm really excited to read Compass, which is about, I think it's over the course of one night and during one strange fever. And that's also one that I bought over the summer but haven't gotten around to reading because there are so many books in this world. And then where does time go? I suppose when you watch all 75 episodes of The Americans and then sort of want to rewatch it, it goes there a little bit. But I'm really enjoying the titles from these Fitzcarraldo editions. Like, they're really great, and I like the design of it as well. So I will report back on this. And then we have some nonfiction. So this was another one there's two that we read in our book club at Life's Library. On Immunity is the most recent one by Eula, Biss, and I think in the UK it's a Fitzcarraldo edition. So like this blue one is one of this family. But this was Celeste Ng's pick for Life's Library, and I absolutely loved it, and it arrived in September, I think it was when we read it, and I had such a sense of like, oh, I didn't really want to read a book about a pandemic right now, but it was exactly what I needed. It was so soothing. It's part memoir, part history of vaccination, part history of all of that, but then also this memoir, and also a real guide to finding compassion for people who are afraid of vaccinations. And I'm so glad I read it at the time I did, because since then, obviously, we've had this amazing news about the vaccine, and like, we already have 800,000 doses in the UK, and they're starting to roll out here already. And I've had people close to me express their fears about the vaccine, and it's really given me a language and a sort of patience with which to talk to people about it. So yes, I loved I loved On Immunity. I thought it was absolutely fantastic. And I really loved how, as it suggests on the cover here, it tied in mythology and other storytelling. That for me is so, so effective. Like Sapiens does that masterfully. And I thought On Immunity was absolutely brilliant. And then the final Life's Library pick that I want to mention is Mountains Beyond Mountains, which is the history of partners in health, specifically of Dr. Paul Farmer. And I think for me, it really returned the humanity to a lot of what we're going through, as did things like the NHS clap, and reading individual stories of people who've gone through it and sort of what it all involved. I think with something like a pandemic and with a virus that is transmitted through, you know, through air and through droplets, it's very hard to ground it, and sometimes it can feel, because it is on a huge scale, like it will just take over everything forever and there's no end in sight. And I think the stories of how Dr. Paul Farmer and his colleagues helped people living in the worst conditions during epidemics and pandemics, and found solutions there that were people-centered and centered the patients and their experiences and what they needed, that was very helpful for me to remember as we were going through all of this. Two other apocalypse pandemic books I've read, Notes from an Apocalypse, I absolutely loved. This was recommended to me on, I want to say on Twitter, by Martha Connell. And again, one that was published, I believe, this year. It's talking about the sense of apocalypse, of climate apocalypse, of the very wealthy men, mostly men, let's be honest, billionaires and so on, who buy bunkers and have put money into their like post-apocalypse plan, a security plan, which is so fascinating to me and also so absolutely horrifying. But I thought it really gave me such a good sense of why it is that we're so fixated on apocalypse, and also the ways in which a lot of that is already happening because specifically of the climate crisis. It also explores the fascination with prepping and survivalists and like how that's kind of evolved over time, and this sort of like consumerism focus of it. As I'm making this video, I'm realizing how many little pages I flagged down, and I want to read you from a few of them. Whatever. Writing in the New York Times in 1961, the anthropologist Margaret Mead suggested that anxieties about nuclear war and urban crime had caused a mass retreat to the suburbs, where middle-class Americans were hiding from the world and its darkening future. The armed individual shelter, she wrote, is the logical end of this retreat from trust in and responsibility for others. So it was that, again, that parallel from like moving from community to individual that was threaded throughout this. Looking around the auditorium, I was struck by the general agedness of the assembled Mars enthusiasts. Perhaps it had to do with it being a Thursday morning, a time of the week more amenable to retirees and writers of literary nonfiction than to the typical gainfully employed Angelino. But the average age seemed to me to hover somewhere around the mid-60s. And it was impossible to overlook the overwhelming whiteness of the room. Of the perhaps 200 or so earthlings who'd shown up for Zubrin's keynote, only one as far as I could see was black, and he happened to be stationed behind the video camera set up at the rear of the room. Here, I surmised, for professional reasons, rather than any deep personal enthusiasm for colonising distant worlds. I kept hearing this word, colonising, and it seemed to me a strange and revealing choice of terminology, given the significant weight of historical baggage attached to the whole project of colonialism. But the prospect of building a human civilization on Mars had a deeper motivation than of ensuring the survival of the species. It was a fantasy of retrieving the idea of the future from the past, recuperating a 20th century optimism and excitement about technology and science, and rehabilitating it for the present. It was, in this sense, an exercise in future nostalgia. Oh god, I loved this book so much. That was the thing about Mars. When people talked about it, they were always simultaneously talking about something else. As often as not, when people were talking about Mars, they were talking about America. But then nobody was ever just talking about America either, because America, famously, was not so much a country as an idea. It was, specifically, the idea of itself as being an idea. The topic was, in this way, always threatening to spiral off into the low Earth orbit of abstraction. Something like this point had been made decades ago by Carl Sagan, the beloved astronomer and host of the enduringly popular 1980s PBS show Cosmos. Sagan was always being invoked by Mars enthusiasts, often it seemed to me as a kind of emotional shorthand for a childlike cosmic optimism that had been lost since the twilight of the space age. Mars, he said, has become a kind of mythic arena onto which we've projected our earthly hopes and fears. So it is in that strange genre that I have grown to so love, non-fiction, memoir, essays, sort of informational, historical interview, like all of these things that cross over in so many ways, and very much of this moment. Like, this to me, more than so many books, is the book of 2020 and really of like how we got here, in the sense, not so much even in the focus of pandemics, but in the response to it, and again, who was prioritized, and how certain people got away with things as well, and how individuals view their own futures as sometimes very separate from the collective, very driven to particular futures that will allow them to recapture something that they feel like has been taken away from them and that they're entitled to. And then I read Zadie Smith's Intimations, which was given to me for my birthday. Zadie Smith, one of my absolute favourites, and flagged a lot of things in this too. I think this is just 6 essays. It is, in fact, 6 essays. Very quick to read, and one of several lovely little books that I like just like having as little tasters. Writing about the experience of lockdown specifically, I have no idea what the turnaround was on all of this, but it just kind of came out very quickly. Now I am gratified to find this most honest of phrases in everybody's mouths all of a sudden, and an answer to almost every question. Why did you bake that banana bread? It was something to do. Why did you make a fort in your living room? Well, it's something to do. Why dress the dog as a cat? It's something to do, isn't it? Fill the time. Out of an expanse of time, you carve a little area that nobody asked you to carve, and you do something. But perhaps the difference between the kind of something that I'm used to and this new culture of doing something is the moral anxiety that surrounds it. The something that artists have always done is more usually cordoned off from the rest of society, and by mutual agreement this space is considered a sort of charming but basically useless playpen, in which adults get to behave like children, making up stories and drawing pictures and so on, though at least they provide some form of pleasure to serious people doing actual jobs. The more utilitarian-minded defenders of art justify its existence by insisting upon its potential political efficacy, which is usually overstated. Artists themselves are especially fond of overstating it. But even if you believe in the potential political efficacy of art, as I do, few artists would dare count on its timeliness. That just gives you a sample of it. There's so much humour in it, but also so much wonderful insight, and I just love Zadie Smith so very much. The final book I'm going to mention today is one that I have not read yet. It's non-fiction, but I am very much looking forward to reading. It's Laura Spinney's Pale Rider, which is about how the 1918 influenza epidemic, known as the Spanish flu, changed the world. Really looking forward to this, and we'll talk about it on here once I've read it. Whether you like it or not, sorry. But yeah, I'd be really interested to hear about other books about pandemics, dystopia, apocalypse. You kind of get a sense of what I like to read from all of that. And yes, wondering whether you have been enjoying reading this kind of thing, or you have been choosing something completely different, avoiding the genre entirely. And maybe those of you who've been really, really avoiding the genre have probably stopped this video a long time ago. But yes, I am looking forward to reading these and whatever else comes along my way. So thank you for watching my very festive video about pandemic fiction and nonfiction. Okay, see you tomorrow. Bye.